Hello and welcome to the worship service of Talbott Cumberland Presbyterian Church. Although we are offering in-person services now at 11 a.m. on Sunday mornings, we want to offer this online service for anyone who cannot be with us or prefers to worship at home.
We'll be offering the same message and the same music in both venues, and we just want to express our gratitude and appreciation that you're joining us for worship today.
We're here at Panther Creek Park. It's a beautiful park. You can see the lake, and it reminds us of the beauty of God's world.
In this worship service, we're reminded of the wonders of God's creation and the beauty of this world. It's Trinity Sunday, and we experience God's love and presence in so many different ways.
So we invite you to worship with us as we consider God's creative activities in this world, for this is our Father's world.
This is my Father's world, and to my listening ears, all nature sings and round me ring the music of the spheres. This is my Father's world, I rest here.
Past months of quarantine, we found ourselves with extra time to do things that we didn't normally have time to do, like cooking and spending extra time with family members and reading. I hope that you've taken extra time to do some more in-depth Bible reading and scripture study.
Karen and I have enjoyed this time to look more deeply at the scriptures. You know, as we delve into scriptures, we find themes and ideas that develop from the very first chapters all the way through the Old and the New Testament.
It's important to understand when we're reading the scriptures, to understand what the words meant to the people to whom they were written, to understand their context. And it's the job of every Christian to understand how those principles and ideas apply to our daily lives.
And so now as Karen reads to us the first chapter of the Bible, Genesis 1, let's consider what that chapter means for us.
Genesis 1 sets the stage for everything that will unfold in the Old and New Testament. As I read chapter 1, consider in your mind the story of creation. What images come to mind as you hear this story? In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was without form and void, and darkness was on the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the waters. Then God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. And God saw the light, that it was good, and God divided the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. So the evening and the morning were the first day. Chances are, if you're like me, when you hear the word earth, the image that comes to your mind is this beautiful blue-green marble floating in space. This is an image that comes to mind for modern people, but really it's an image that we humans only first saw in the 1960s with the Apollo space exploration. In the ancient mind, the heavens and the earth didn't conjure up this kind of an image of a globe floating in space. Rather, to the ancient mind, the term heavens and earth meant that there was an area of heaven and then of land below it, because this is what they saw in their everyday lives.
In the very first verse of the Bible, we're given a reference to heaven, or heavens. In Hebrew, the word heaven is actually always in plural. It's the heavens. And so in this verse, in this first reference, we're given this image of heavens as a realm that is very different from this earthly realm in which we all share. And so the word heaven or heavens is used in this first verse, and the biblical writers return again and again to the image of heavens as a place where God dwells. It's where God is. For instance, in Isaiah 63, it says, "Lord, look down from heaven. Look from your holy, glorious home and see us." Psalm 11 says, "The Lord is in his holy temple. The Lord still rules from heaven. He watches everyone closely, examining every person on earth." And so in the Old Testament, there is an understanding that there is this place that's very different from the place you and I live, the place of humanity, and that is the heavens. The heavens are the place of God. And as it says in Psalm 11, this place is oftentimes associated in the Old Testament with the imagery of the temple. So the temple is the home of God and the heavens are the home of God. On the other hand, humanity, you and I, we dwell on earth. And earth is described very differently. In the passage that Karen read in Genesis 1, it says this, "The earth was without form and void, and darkness was on the face of the deep." Without form and void. One Bible lexicon describes this as a place of chaos, a vast and utter wasteland. And so we have that image, and paired with that image is this image of deep, dark waters, the face of the deep, the Bible says. And these two images of this vast wasteland and this place of the deep, they would have had a lot of significance for the people of Israel. The land of ancient Israel was bordered by Egypt and the desert. For the ancients, the desert represented a vast, hostile, inhospitable land, a kind of a wasteland where you didn't want to live. You couldn't survive all that long in the desert. And so that was on one side of Israel. On the other side of Israel, then the people looked out and saw the Mediterranean Sea. Israel was bordered by the Mediterranean Sea. 3,000 years ago, the sea was an equally inhospitable place. Sailors would go out on these tiny ships in the midst of this vast sea, and they'd be tossed around. Their lives would be threatened and sometimes lost. So the sea was another form of wasteland, a threatening, chaotic force. And so we have a picture of Israel. Israel is this green strip of land, and it's in the midst of, on one side, this vast desert, on another side, the sea. And the biblical writer draws on these two chaotic images in picturing what the earth is. This is the earth, different from heaven. And we shouldn't be surprised. Chaos still reigns on the earth. This is still the realm of chaos. You know, look at the news with disease and racial tension. We live in a world that's filled with chaos. And God, it says again and again in the Bible, seeks to address the issue of chaos.
Genesis 1 says, "The Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the waters." The Spirit of God was hovering over the waters. In the scriptures, the word that the Hebrews used was ruach, and that word can have three different meanings in English. The first meaning that we understand is breath, that of breath. Now, over these past weeks, as we've been wearing masks in public places, we've become very aware of breath, the life-giving power of breath. Ruach can also mean wind, like the great rushing wind that came in on Pentecost. And it can also mean the Holy Spirit, that the wind of the Holy Spirit comes in and refreshes our lives. And so even in this very first scripture passage about the Holy Spirit hovering, the Ruach hovering over the waters, we see in that the Trinity, the image of three different ways that the Spirit works in our lives. In the Gospel of John, the writer adds to this image of creation. John 1 says, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made." It's as if the writer of John takes the story of creation and allows us to catch a glimpse of the Trinity from the very beginning of time. That the Trinity was there at the beginning of creation. Now, the Trinity is very difficult to understand. In Acts chapter 2, it talks about the Holy Spirit coming, and then we go on to learn that we're to live and move and have our being in God. And this is very difficult for us to understand. But the goal of living in the Spirit isn't to understand God, but to be known by God and to live in God and to allow God to live through us. And so it is from the very beginning that the Spirit of God was hovering over the earth, over the chaos. And it is through Jesus Christ that Jesus walked on the water and calmed it. And then the Holy Spirit works in our lives to calm our spirit and to calm our lives during very tumultuous times. And it's in fact through Christ that we gain peace throughout the challenges of our lives.
Genesis continues in this way. It says, "Then God said, let there be light, and there was light. And God saw the light, that it was good, and God divided the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night." God speaks. God uses God's breath, ruach, to say the words, "Let there be light," and there was light. Now let me ask you this. What is being created? What's being created in this first day? Well, is it the sun? No, is it photons? You know, our question about what's being created on this particular day, that reveals something about how we're thinking about this story. We're thinking about the story as like, what does God create on this day? And what thing does God create on this next day? And then what thing does God create on this next day? But is that what the Hebrew text, is this what the Bible is telling us in this particular passage? It really talks about God bringing order to the world. We have this picture of this world that's in vast chaos, this earth that's in vast, it's a chaotic wasteland. And God brings order. God divides the light from the darkness. He creates order in that. God divides the waters below from the waters above. He creates order. God orders the seasons on the next day. And so God is the God of order. God is not the God of chaos. He's not the God of a chaotic world. God brings order and meaning to life. And then on the sixth day of creation, what happens? On the sixth day of creation, God creates humanity. God creates people in his own image. In fact, Genesis 1 says this, "So God created human beings in his own image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them." In the ancient world, there were rulers who ruled vast domains. They ruled these empires, which would encompass what would be many nations. And these rulers would set up for themselves these images, these statues throughout their vast kingdom. Here is an image of Alexander the Great. And this is a statue of Caesar. You can see the image of Caesar, the ruler of the Roman Empire. These statues gave people in distant lands an opportunity to see their ruler. You know, they could never travel to Rome or to Athens. It was far too distant. And yet, when they looked at the statue, they could see the image of the emperor. In Genesis 1, it tells us that in creating people, that God created people in God's image. You know, the realms of earth and heaven, they're very distinct realms. Earth is this chaotic realm. Heaven is painted as the place of God. And yet, in creating people, God put into each person the image of God. There is some overlap there. We're told in the second chapter of Genesis, we're told the story of the Garden of Eden, this earthly paradise in which earth, the realm, the world of earth, the realm of earth and heaven completely overlap. And people in the garden, people walk with God. And yet sin enters that garden and people are expelled from that garden and so are once again find themselves distanced from this realm of heaven. They find themselves at odds, and sin and dissension rule. The world is a chaotic world. It remains a place of sin and chaos. And yet, we're called. The story of the Bible is all about trying to find that place in which heaven and earth reconnect. And in Christ, in the triune God of the Father, the Son, and the Spirit, the God is trying to bring those worlds back together in our lives. In fact, in Philippians 3 says, our citizenship is in heaven, and from it we await a Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. Ultimately, our citizenship is not in this world. It is with God and God's plan for our lives. The Bible says that we are citizens of heaven.
Let's close with the Lord's Prayer. In this prayer, we see the connection between heaven and earth. From the beginning of time, from the very first chapter in Genesis, to Jesus' prayer, to the apocalyptic scriptures of John, we see this connection between heaven and earth, and God's desire for us to live in peace. Let's bow together. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Holy, holy.